Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, for the India Food Nutrition Summit 2021. That was a very insightful presentation by Mr. Raj Sahitya from DSM on an interesting topic on food fortification and food application. Now we move on to our next panel session of the day on a very interesting topic on probiotics as functional foods effects on human health. Some of the key pointers that would be discussed in this session will be on probiotic food products, classes, types and processing, the future trends and perspective on probiotic nutrition, regulatory framework and policies for probiotic nutrition and many more. And to discuss on this topic, I would like to invite the panel members in the order of sequence. Mr. Sanjay Pandey, General Manager for Quality from Banas Dairy. Hi. Joining Mr. Pandey, we have Mr. Kajal Devnath, Chief Regulatory Officer for DFM Foods. Next, we have Dr. T. Joseph David, Head Regulatory Affairs and Analytical Services for Tata Consumer. Joining Dr. David, we have Mr. Prabhakar Mishra, Assistant Director, Food Regulatory Affairs for Fatty Van Mill. Next, we have Mr. Adam Beaker, Director Science for CHR Hansen. Now, I would like to introduce Dr. Neerja Hachela, Head Science and Regulatory Affairs from Yakult Danone India, who is also the moderator for this particular panel session. So, Dr. Hachela, all over to you.
Thank you, Devanshi. Thank you for that very kind introduction. And it's such a privilege and an honor to be moderating this esteemed panel discussion on a topic which is very close to my heart, probiotics. So, without much ado, I'm going to kickstart the panel discussion. So, just to begin and give a view a background of why probiotics are so important. Ever since we've realized that we are more microbes than human cells, and we harbor 100 trillion microorganisms which weigh about 2 kilograms and impact almost every aspect of human health, interventions like probiotics, which can favorably modify the intestinal microbes, they can increase the beneficial components, have now taken center stage. And therefore, they are becoming increasingly important. And in that context, in India, of course, there's been a lot of awareness about probiotics, but there's still some confusion about traditional fermented foods being probiotic. So I'd really like to know the difference between traditional fermented foods and probiotics, if there is any. And I'll request Dr. Adam Beaker, who's the probiotic man from Chris Hansen, to tell us about this in greater detail. Over to you, Dr. Adam.
Thank you so much, Dr. Neerja. Yeah, I think I would just like to say to begin with that the traditional fermented foods, and I know some of the other panelists will add to this, are not probiotic by definition. When we're talking about probiotics, but what we're going to talk about today on the panel, and you'll be hearing much more about, is we're talking about some of those microbes that you just mentioned at the beginning, probiotic bacteria. And these are specific strains or bacteria that actually been demonstrated to have health benefits, and how we actually consume them or eat them in a matrix of a specific dairy product or as a supplement is one thing we'll be discussing. But the point is, it is that the bacteria or the actual strain of bacteria in that product has actually been demonstrated scientifically to have a health benefit. And that is something we have to work very hard at to understand. So although traditional fermented foods are good, very nice, they are not by definition probiotic. We do, and what you hear today is the discussions of how we as the industry and scientists are actually working to demonstrate some particular strain of certain benefits and how we can demonstrate what those benefits are pretty systematically. And then the person knows what they're getting. And we have regulations and clinical trials to actually understand that. So yes, there is a very big difference when we talk about traditional fermented foods and probiotics, and I really hope that everyone understand more about that today. I think one of my other panel members has maybe something to add.
Yeah. Sanjay, you being the dairy man, would you like to add something to this?
Yeah, I will like to add, because see, the most important thing is the food and the food ingredients.
Sanjay, I think you're mute. We cannot hear you very clearly. Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
we
so
can.
The most important aspect for the conventional food is that they put in nitrogen.
Can I request all the panel members to please mute themselves? Please mute themselves, please. Yeah.
So the most important aspect is that most important aspect is that food should have live microorganisms. So when we talk about the live organisms, they could be bacteria, they could be yeast also, but mostly if you talk about the dairy based foods, they are generally bacteria and they are beneficial bacteria, and they should not be subjected to any high heat treatment or kind of products where they are already inactivated. So we cannot call them probiotics if the bacteria is not live in the food. For example, our traditional foods like idli is also a kind of fermented food. We make in India like milk-based curries, typically with gram flour and all. They are all cooked products and there is no live bacteria. Similarly, we have buttermilk which are thermized and they are available in UHT packs. So we cannot call them probiotic food, whether they are of the traditional origin or they are modern food like UHT or thermized food. If beneficial organisms are not live and they are not meeting a certain number in the product or the serving, and they are not listed in the country by the food regulators, then probably we cannot call them probiotics. So it has to be listed organism in your country. There should be live beneficial bacteria, and there should be a certain number of bacteria which should be available per serving. So that is very important.
So what are the application of probiotics in dairy-based foods, Sanjay? Given that you have clearly clarified that, you know, probiotics tested and they have they have to be in a certain number and give a health benefit. So what are your applications of probiotics in dairy foods?
So yeah, very good question. And I would like to say that milk is a very diverse food medium or material. And when I say diverse, I mean that it can be used as food, it can be used as food ingredient. Milk is available in liquid form, in semi-solid form, in dry form like milk powders. It is fermented, non-fermented, sweet, sour, salt, spicy, flavored. So you have all the diverse range in the milk and milk products. And when we talk about all this diversity that milk brings into the food, probiotics can be used in any of these formats. For example, if you talk about fermented foods and the foods which are semi-solid or drink format, for example, dahi, yogurt, even cottage cheese, where you see that probiotics are very popular. But when we go to, for example, dry foods like powder, there also, only thing is that the food is very much regulated in the liquid or fermented format. Like you need to have the certain number of organisms. Regulators have already defined, like for dairy products, if they are a drink or they are yogurt, then there are a certain number of organisms, like 10 to the power 8 organisms should be available per serving. So it could be in the dry format, it could be in the liquid format, it could be in the powder form also, because these probiotics can be encapsulated these days, they can be freeze-dried, they can be available as a frozen food also. So it is very much possible that we can use across diverse food, you can use as food ingredients, so application could be really very wide.
So basically you're saying that all kinds of milk and milk products could be
they can be made,
you know,
probiotic.
Preferred carrier matrix for probiotic strains.
They can be made probiotic, and these foods can have probiotics and prebiotics also. But all these foods are not probiotics. You need to make.
Understood. Yes, you have to formulate it to a probiotic product. Yeah. Understood. Okay. Understood.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Dr. Adam mentioned the word scientifically tested bacteria. That raises a question in my mind that are probiotics foods or drugs? So that question is to Dr. David, that are probiotics foods or drugs, and what are the regulatory challenges that you have to face? Dr. David?
Yes. Thanks, Dr. Nirja. See, you asked a very basic question whether probiotics are food or drug. As you all know that we have clear definition of what is food and what is a drug. I'm talking about India primarily. And if you want to call your probiotic as a food, then it has to follow certain defined parameters and it has to meet certain criteria set by the food regulator. But if you wanted to put it as a drug, because you are seeing a lot of probiotic strains, live bacteria as capsules, as a medicine it is being sold. But then you need to follow the Drugs and Cosmetic Act, what need to be followed there. It has to be live and it need to exhibit or demonstrate certain medical benefits. And if need to be called as a medicine or even health supplement, most of them are sold under the bracket of health supplement. You need to follow that. But if that need to be classified as food, then certain regulatory requirement need to be met. So as you know that FSSAI has clearly defined what is probiotic and what is a probiotic food. If you look at the history of probiotics, probably the first definition came in 2001 from WHO-FAO, which says that any organism which can provide any live organism that when administered in inadequate amounts, if it confers a health benefit to a host. This is the basic definition of probiotic given by WHO-FAO way back in 2001. So that clearly says that it has to be a live organism. And in the 2016 when FSSAI came out with the nutraceutical regulations, there also it is clearly defining what do you mean by a food with added probiotics. It means that food with live microorganism beneficial to human health, which when ingested in required amount as a single or a multiple strain, would provide one or more specific health benefits. So it is clearly defined what is a food if probiotic to be treated as a food. So probiotic is generally used as such, it is rarely used in food, but it is always in a food matrix it is being used. So please go on.
So you're saying that we have probiotics as foods as well as probiotics as drugs, and they're regulated by different authorities.
Different
authorities. The Drug and Cosmetic Act and then the FSSAI, the Food Safety Standards Authority.
It has to meet the specific requirement defined by these two agencies. Then it meets the requirement.
So also, I think probiotics.
Yeah, go ahead.
I think probiotic foods, we cannot use terms like prevent, treat, cure, you know?
Yeah,
when it comes to drugs, it's all about treatment of disease.
Yeah.
So that must be the basic difference, yeah.
Yeah. There is no claim on preventing, treating, or curing a disease condition. That is the primary requirement specified by the food regulator in India.
Yes,
but
yes.
It says that it can take into consideration the healthful benefits, modifying a certain conditions like supports digestive system or digestive function, that type of
or immunity.
What is the allowed studies based on the studies done or supporting the particular aspect is clearly defined by FSSAI.
Thank you, Dr. David. That very clearly put out. And then I'm going to ask Dr. Bhavkar Mishra, that what are the regulatory challenges for marketing a probiotic food? You know, I mean, we know now we have drugs, we have food. So what are the regulatory challenges that a manufacturer has to probably face when he wants to sell a probiotic food, and the kind of claims that he can make on a probiotic food?
Yeah, so thank you so much, Neerja. It's really very important and fundamental question when anyone actually manufactures probiotic foods. So as explained by Dr. David, so there are actually regulatory framework which are supposed to be fulfilled by any manufacturer of probiotic food. So once it is compliant to those requirements, then it becomes easy for any company to market and sell its probiotic food. But yes, there are actually population in India largely who are not aware about probiotic foods as such. Although, as you said, they are aware about something like curd and means chhach, which are actually known to have some amount of live organism which are beneficial to the gut. But per se probiotic, large population is not aware as such. Because probiotic means, as also said by other panelists, that it has to have minimum 10^8 CFU per gram or per serve of the live microorganism to get the claimed benefit. So in order to reach to the consumer, all these things are supposed to be actually well communicated in terms of marketing. So to have that, maybe people are actually aware in the cities but about what is probiotic, but particularly in the rural areas, in the means B-class town or C-class town, people are not aware about it. So maybe means conferences could be organized there, and it could be also part of the curriculum in the school, like they know about vitamins, minerals, but they don't know about what is probiotic. So basic education has to be given about the probiotic. Also, it could be also made as part of the midday meal in the school. Because there are actually well-known benefits of probiotic foods. And apart from this, there could be PPP model to further means provide communication, which will further help in marketing of these products, like Eat Right movement, which was undertaken by FSSAI. Maybe organizations or associations who are manufacturer of probiotics, they can tie up with FSSAI and other industry association to further means communicate about the benefits of probiotic foods. And you know, digital platform is something which is really means which can be leveraged by the industry and those who are manufacturer of probiotic. Social media is there. So we know that more than 50 crores of people in India currently used this smartphones. So it can be very well leveraged by creating positive messages, awareness about probiotic, what are health benefits, because we come to know that it also provides immunity, and whenever any antibiotic is administered, so it actually damages useful microflora in our gut, intestine. So these things are actually not known to the consumers fundamentally. So these things must be actually made aware, educated, which will further help in communicating and marketing of these products. Because in India, we know that up to some extent, actually we lack in terms of these things, in terms of the awareness and education, which is the need of the hour currently.
Yeah, people know probiotics, but they don't know what they are. And they don't know what they're doing for us. So, you know, people are very skeptical about picking up a probiotic product because they really don't know what it is doing for you. Vitamins, minerals, we all know. We know vitamin C, we know zinc, we know. But very true. So Prabhakar very nicely put, and you used one term, and that is immunity. When we talk about probiotics, one thing that comes out very strong is immunity. Yeah. And in this pandemic of COVID-19, it's all been about immune boosting foods. So, Dr. Adam, what is your take on probiotics for building your immune system, given that about 70% of our immune system, the gut associated lymphoid tissue, is located in the gut? And what are the mechanisms, if any, about how probiotics really boost your immune system?
Great, thank you, Dr. Neerja. It's a great discussion, and I think I would just link back to the last comments as well about the the education. It's a fascinating field, but we need to be able to educate people more on it. What is a probiotic? So we've understood that a probiotic is something that gives a health benefit. One of these major benefits we're hearing about is boosting the immune system. What we do know is now scientifically is showing that the microbiome and all of these beneficial microbes we've talked about are so important. People and the consumers are starting to understand this, that your microbiome is very, very important. It's with you through life and you can alter it. We just heard about antibiotics and other things affecting that. And you've also introduced yourself exactly a very important point. We have a microbiome in our gut, and surrounding this in this microbiome, 70% of your immune system is located in your gastrointestinal system. So there's an intimate connection automatically closely between these bacteria there in your microbiome and the immune system. And what's really important is, and I can't emphasize it enough for today's discussions and for consumers to understand, is that there are certain strains, certain bacterial strains, which we could call probiotic, which can affect, and maybe we can say support, immune functions. Some other probiotics support other types of gastrointestinal or other health. And I think this is where some of the confusion comes, and it's really, really important that everyone is working to sort of educate and understand that certain strains, certain probiotic strains, have a very beneficial effect on immunity. And that's what we are trying to understand and study. And some of us here are in companies or in science where you're doing that. You take a probiotic strain and you demonstrate that it's in adequate amounts, either in a supplement or in food, beverage, or in a dairy product. And then you demonstrate how it's actually affecting the immune system, how it can boost the immune system. And what we can demonstrate and what we can talk about here is you can actually see and measure in clinical trials where people are getting the probiotic strain or not getting the probiotic strain. You can see how there are elements in your immune system without getting too technical. And we can see how the bacteria are able to talk and communicate with your immune system and help it boost the signal, we say. So it's boosting your immune system. Yes. So it supports your immune health. And that's what we're looking at, that we can demonstrate in the labs and in people that you can actually show how the signaling mechanisms of your own immune system are increased when you take certain types of strains, and not all strains, just certain types of strains.
Types of strains,
yeah. Important. So.
Yeah, so probiotic benefits are very strain specific. That is another thing that we need to understand, that very, every probiotic is not absolutely not giving you the same health benefit. Absolutely.
No, so we do know that there are some strains, and this is, of course, very, very important in these times. And we've been studying this actually for many years, but of course, the consumers, all of us, myself, are very interested in making sure my immune system is at its strongest.
Yes.
Specifically look for, and that's what I think consumers, and we talk about the education, need to do to be able to look for and find those products or the strains that have scientifically been demonstrated to actually have these effects. And that's what we're looking for, and to help educate this.
I agree with you, Dr. Adam. It's a lot to do with the scientifically validated health benefits.
Yes.
Whatever we are talking about when it comes to probiotics, whether it's the gastrointestinal system or it is, now we know there are many more areas where probiotics have been found to be useful, but it is a scientifically proven health benefit which becomes very, very important, and strain specific health benefit. So excellent. We are talking now about health benefits of probiotics, and taking it from there, I'm going to ask Dr. Kajal a question. That we all know that India is grappling with a triple burden of nutrition. It's undernutrition, it's overnutrition, it's hidden hunger. So how do you think probiotics could be a useful intervention in a country like India? How could it help to improve the health of the nation, as you may say, Dr. Kajal?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Nirja. And also, I would really congratulate Senex to organize at this time of, you know, testing time of tough time of COVID pandemic. This is very relevant to really we talk about this. And as my previous speaker, Dr. Adam, has said that this is something, there are specific exhibiting benefits of bacteria are there, and it is the microbiome, it is the gut, which is something can resolve a lot of issues related to health and nutrition. So if I look at the goodness of these probiotics, prebiotic, symbiotic, all these things has to be, somehow this goodness cannot be restricted to individual understanding. As Prabhakar ji has said that this has to be disseminated among the large population, then only the country's health and nutrition really can progress. So is it something to really leverage this goodness? Can you think of how we can have a participation of government regulators? I'm talking about more macro things first to really put the things in order. So today we have a nutrition policy per se that Poshan Abhiyan is there. Now in Poshan Abhiyan, can we include this that probiotic, prebiotic, symbiotics and all these kind of scientific things which is going to exhibit a lot of benefits to Indian population? How can we include that? How, Mr. Prabhakar also said that, is it included in the midday meal? Because today's children, today's the generations, if we are able to really make them, have this understanding and ingestion of these probiotics, prebiotics, these will have a cascading effect over generations together. Like what we talk about food fortifications, food fortification, I'll give you example, classic example of in India, we don't see any kind of iron, iodine deficiencies issues. Because in 1962, it was instituted. And today, we are having no issues. But we are having a lot of future issues. And hence, it is very important that these probiotics has to be made into popularized. In some countries, like I was told, in Australia and all, dairy products by default are probiotics. I mean, in India, we have a normal curd. We have a normal, dairy drinks. And then we have some kind of probiotic drink. So this is something which is, if we are able to really make it affordable to technology, to means, then I think this is going to have beneficial to for our future generations. We understand that there could be a very other scientific things which is can be a niche, but there are certain things which is required for the country. We need to really make this probiotic accessible to everywhere. There are some regulatory mechanism has been built in current, FSSAI regulations saying that even the normal, the dairy products, fermented products needs to have a certain amount of 10 to the power 6 CFU per, gram of your products. But in case of probiotic, it is 10 to the power 8. So now can we only, why can't we make a normal card with probiotics only? Why we need to, make that probiotic is a different product? Card is a different products. So more you are able to make it that let all our products, let even the indulgence products everywhere, let's have this probiotic. And I'm sure that there is a science and there are a lot of science has been developed. There are validated, research papers are there, people have been doing. And another thing I just wanted to add, these from ancient time, there is a prebiotics ingestion by our, dietic from Vedic time itself has been, found in the research papers that because of that, what happens, the gut microflora is always been maintained in a balanced way, protecting this thing from against all that kind of things and developing immune system and also exerting various kind of good benefits, which already we are having in our GI system. So those are the things has to be brought back, has to be brought into the systems. And so today we are living in uncertainty. Today COVID has hit. We don't know.
Times are tomorrow. Different. Yes.
So why don't you utilize the knowledge of probiotics, prebiotics? There are various, specific strain oriented, more research, more universities, more academicians has to take participation in these. Let's develop on that. Then there is a, it could be in the form of drugs, it could be in the form of food. Let's explore everything. And let's talk about in that sense to really improve the nutrition status of the country. I think this is the way
that
we should
be very important.
And not only restricted only towards the, a kind of probiotic science, which we from a legacy we are being understanding. I think time has come, we should break that, and we should really, like we are talking about now, to save our world, that no, you have made these vaccines, so let me also use these vaccines, not to remain in the territory. And we are discussing in a WTO kind of situation. So do you want to every time to have this situation, you know, ready, and then you go to WTO, rather than the science community and government everywhere should work together and really think about it and how we can really, you know, prepare ourselves for the future. And I think we have a potential in probiotic, prebiotics, symbiotics, and all this stuff. That's what I think. So.
With you, but I think the education is very important. The understanding, consumer understanding is important. A consumer understands, like I said, vitamins and minerals, but does not really understand the probiotics. So I think more important is for a consumer to understand the importance and the need for a probiotic, you know, as a part of the daily diet before we can really bring it to that level. But I agree with you that, you know, it is a very, very important area, and especially given that gut health is becoming so important, taking center stage today, because the gut is not only the largest immune system, it has those 100 trillion microbes, and it is also the second brain of the human body. And because of gut health being so important, you know, probiotics are getting so much of an importance and becoming increasingly important. But having said that, I go back to dairy and I ask Sanjay that what are your commonly used probiotic organisms? We've heard of lactobacillus, we've heard of bifidobacteria, and also saccharomyces as an yeast. But what are the organisms that you all are using in dairy foods?
So thank you for this question. It is a very good question, and what I would like to say that for most of the organisms and living beings, milk is a very good food. It's a very good substrate. I'm not talking so much about the plants, but most of the living beings, they are surviving on milk. And same is true for microorganisms also. And for them, it is a very good substrate. They can thrive on it. And if typically you look about think about the microorganisms, they are mostly probiotic microorganisms. They are typically from lactobacillus. They are also bifidobacterium. There are yeasts also, but they are not so much used in the dairy industry. Maybe in the cereal and other products, their application. And when we talk about the typical organisms, again, this is something probiotic is a very regulated food subject, and it needs to be listed by the local food authorities in that particular country. So in our country, it is listed in Schedule 7 of FSSI. So, and this, if you see the list of microorganisms there, the typical dahi or yogurt cultures, like if you see a Streptococcus thermophilus, you see Lactobacillus, Lactobacillus cremosus, Timoris, etc. They are there, and they were traditionally also they were present in the dahi or the yogurt kind of product. But there are other microorganisms which, like it is told, that certain strains will bring more beneficial effects on the health. So that is a very well researched subject. Most of the suppliers of the probiotics, they have conducted their studies, clinical trials, they have scientific evidence, etc., to substantiate, and they can provide also, like if one wants to use that kind of ingredient, they will provide.
The sensation is. Chris Hansen has all the strains, and we can use many of those. Correct. Yes. Thank you, Sanjay. Yes, and we have limited time now. We have just about 7 minutes to go. So I'm just quickly going to ask Devyanshi, are there any questions from the audience? Devyanshi? Devyanshi, are any questions from the audience for the panel members?
No, as of now, we do not have any questions. If there are any questions that come up, I will let you know.
Sure. And Devyanshi, how much time do we have?
You have 10 minutes.
Okay. So I can, after Sanjay, come back to Dr. David. about what, how strong is the scientific data that we have for our probiotic products? What do you think should be the ideal kind of science that is, that ensures that we can market a probiotic, especially a food? Drugs we know, but what about a food?
Okay, thanks, Dr. Neerja. So I would try to focus on a couple of things, because if you say that how strong is the scientific evidence, as I had mentioned earlier, there is a nutraceutical regulation we have, which clearly yes. defines which are the microorganism or species of microorganism that can be used in probiotic, as probiotic in probiotic foods. There are 30 species defined. Yes. Most of them are lactobacillus and bifidobacterium and dorsacharomyces, couple of them are there. But what is more important now is how is the science behind all these things. Now, Dr. Pandey was mentioning about strain specific. So within a species, you have a strain specific activity or a lot of studies. And Dr. Baker was mentioning about your question on immunity. It is very evident that gut health plays an important role to offer to immunity, and how best we can identify an organism which can contribute specifically to the immunity in the gut health area is yes, something yes. which the science should ideally focus on. And as you know that the government allow or the regulations allow you to have a single strain or a multi-strain, and the studies should directly related to how the functional properties of that particular thing at a defined level of 100 million organisms yeah. per cell need to be defined. And they also allow, it is not necessary that you should have a minimum of 100 million. You can still go down, but that need to be supported by scientific evidence. So it yeah. allows a bit of flexibility there to define on that. And it is very important that without a scientific support, it is very difficult to take it across to the consumers, because we said that consumer is not at all first of place. It is not, all are aware of what is happening in the probiotic field. You know that it is more or less an urban phenomena. People in the rural area is not even aware of what is a probiotic and why somebody should take it. So this sort of awareness is more important. Of these things. And also it is equally important that when you are becoming a species specific and strain specific, you need to be very careful about what science you are going to offer.
Yes.
So that lot of scientific studies are required to support this to have a health claim. Otherwise you have to end up with yes. a no claim on a probiotic food. So ideally science is very strong, and you need to have that much of a support coming from the basic studies to specifically assigning to a strain of a species or a species itself. To,
definitely.
So that the consumer the can benefit from that.
So you spoke about urban and rural education. Yes. So that brings me to Prabhakar ji. What do you think? I mean, if there were two things that you could do to create awareness about probiotics in the rural area, what would those two things be?
Yeah,
urban,
so,
we yet have...
Yeah. So thanks, Neerja. In fact, as I said, that the two things which we could actually implement, one is that means, of course, awareness has to be there, because if you introduce any product, first consumer should know what I am going to consume and what are the benefits, like vitamins and mineral supplements, everybody knows, right? So, in case we introduce midday meal, also part of the midday meal, then consumer should know that what benefits are there. So I think in rural area, it is must to have in terms of the education awareness. And as I said that more than 50 crores of people in India, they are using a smartphone. So users are actually growing up in the rural areas. So how we can leverage that technology in terms of social media, Facebook, etc. So companies who are into this sort of foods, they should actually create some videos or some other message, which could be actually popped up in between the YouTube videos, etc., so that they come to know what are probiotics. that will actually trigger their awareness, and they will means be prompted to use such products, first thing. Second, of course, yeah, so I think PPP model, like you know, whenever there is any rings or call, we come to know that there are too much actually messages about COVID last year and this year also. So likewise, how we can build in, I mean, through radio program, etc., maybe 10 minutes every day in rural areas. People used to hear programs on radios, so that could also be leveraged. If not, could be the part of our ringtone or etc.
So, and in a local language, maybe.
Yeah.
If you have it in a local language, they may understand it much better.
Yeah.
Yes. Thanks. Thank you, Prabhakar ji. So coming back to Kajal, Dr. Kajal, we know that India was a country with infectious diseases at one point, and now it's only NCDs. One of every seven people has got some sort of non-communicable disease, obesity, diabetes. Do you think probiotics could help in this area as well?
With the advent of urban progress, sedentary lifestyle, you know, we stepped in a you know, double burden of the malnutrition. So the persistence of undernutrition alongside rising overweight, obesity suggests that India needs to develop a new nutrition strategies that prioritize double duty actions. So again, I'll go back to the same thing, that gut microbiota composition, and then the presence of chronic, you know, NCDs such as diabetes mellitus, chronic disease, and all that. So all this today, I mean, to science. I mean, even I had interacted with one medical doctor. I mean, like she said that she treats even some of the, you know, patient with having a lot of some skin diseases through probiotics and prebiotics. So there are therapy based probiotics, prebiotics, symbiotic, even postbiotics, and the fecal microbiota transplant, which can represent a useful therapy tools actually. To my knowledge, and then that has to be explored. You know, these are the research studies has been confirmed, but adoptions are not happening actually. Whether is it because of you know, more clarity is required, or it is not inclination of that. But there are cases where people you know, go for such special treatments and they get you know, able to really you know, get these things. So available clinical, experimental, you know, all these research studies shows that even you can have, you know, blood sugar control, you know, type 1 diabetes in children, and all these things are
can be
really you know, available. And I think you know, I don't want to extend, but interesting thing is that these metabiogenic, you know, biotics and biogenics or metabolites, cell-free supernatants, all these things are, these are all emerging things, and as a potential instrument to what basically we are doing, we are modulation the you know, the gut microflora, and you control the dysbiosis, you bring, you know, so there are such kind of things where intracellular soluble factors are there, you really, you know, secreted from the live bacteria, which really helps. So these are the various things which I think, you know, as a testing time of NCDs, because we also seen that even this COVID, that people who are having this, you know, in the verge of having the patients having NCDs, has really got impacted.
So,
and we practice these also parallelly. Now things will improve, and probably these are the things need to be really looked into by, you know, health officials, governments, and all.
Again,
this is something. Yeah.
Yes.
So this is the way, so I think probiotics plays a role for controlling the NCDs and save life.
I think again the science will become very important. We have to have the right amount of science to really, you know, validate what we are. That will become very important. And now looking into the future, Dr. Adam, we know now we are hearing a lot about probiotics for GI for metabolic disorders, obesity, diabetes. But looking even further there, we've heard of the gut-brain axis, and we know that the gut connects the brain through the vagus nerve. So what are your thoughts on, can you envisage a situation where probiotics could actually be useful for, you know, combating some of the neurological conditions?
Yeah, I thank you for the question. It's a very, very interesting point. And the previous speakers, we're talking about the fundamentals, the microbiome, how we can actually fundamentally affect health through actually not just the gut microbiome, but other microbiomes. And yes, we can absolutely see now the link between how certain probiotic strains, scientifically demonstrated, they can do the signaling. We heard about postbiotics and metabolites. They're signaling and actually driving messaging between gut and brain. And so, feelings, when we think about stress, anxiety, all of these things we can now see we're modulating and modifying with working with probiotics. And we can even see it in actually more serious diseases, even that there is an effect on the gut microbiome. But I think what is key, and I'll just end up here from Christian Hansen's point of view, is that we are building the science. And that's what we're learning now. It's the science behind the probiotic strains delivered in the right amount to do the right benefits. Certain strains for immunity, certain strains for health, certain strains for having neurological. And also the education, this is an important area. And actually, Christian Hansen, we're actually developing this very interesting a sort of platform probiotic institute to try and educate. Maybe we need to learn and get this out even more to people. So, I think it's so important that people can understand how can a bacteria in my gut, in my stomach, actually affect even maybe something that's going on in my head. But there's great science being built now. So this is what we have to do, but we have to think about certain strains and build that science, as I just said, to very demonstrate.
True. I had read a very interesting quote. Who's the host? The microbes or us? It's going to be the microbes in the future.
It's going to be the definitely microbes we need
in the future. Yes, yes. So I've got a message from Devyanshi saying there are some questions. Devyanshi?
Yes, we do have questions. So one question is specifically addressed to Dr. Adam Baker. So the question is from Dr. Vasudha Sharma. The question goes, what are the next generation probiotics that CHR Hansen is offering? Also, what are the specific diseases that they target? Over to you.
Okay, so the first part of the question I understood, which is the next generation. I think the next generation, in my mind, is we've discussed today, we have next generations of Lactobacillus and the bifidobacteria, and we're understanding how they work in food matrices or how they work with supplements, and we're targeting and showing how they work in new areas of health, different health areas. We also have, which of course is we're looking at, but that goes down towards a more drug approach, what we call the strict anaerobes. These are the non-approved at the moment bacterial strains. So they're much more regulated from a drug point of view because they're not understood well in the food chain. So, but for me, next generation probiotics is specific strains that have really been demonstrated clinically and scientifically in certain health areas. And that's what we have in the next generation.
Is there another question, Devyanshi?
Yes, yes, we do have another question. It is from Ms. Trilakshmi. She asks, apart from dairy product, where else can we find the food fortification in probiotics?
So who would like to take that? Yeah.
Doctor, so you can take it ahead.
Prabhakar ji, would you like to take that? Or Dr. David?
See, to answer that question, we have been talking about fortification and we are talking about mandatory fortification. We have under these two fortifications, like salt with iodine was a mandatory fortification which started many years back, which actually resulted in disappearance of iodine deficiency related issues. So I was thinking that when you say nutrients, you are always limited to vitamins, minerals and amino acids as per the regulator. But why can't we add probiotics as well into that list and think of, I think somebody need to work with the regulators to work on at least to start with the voluntary fortification or even mandatory fortification, especially on milk products, to so that it can be an ideal vehicle even to reach the far reaching rural population. So it is a very good approach if we try to do it as a mandatory approach to fortification, to include probiotics and consider milk or dairy products as an ideal vehicle for that.
So I think the question, Dr. David, was that other than milk, which are the other matrices which can be used for probiotics, other carrier matrices, say cereals, vegetables, fruit juices?
But I don't know because
yes, in India,
other products actually goes through a processing, but yes. Milk is something which is an ideal thing which has got a very high penetration. It is very difficult to find out a product with more penetration. Then I would say that it is something to do with beverages like tea, which has got the highest penetration. Even water, bottled water. So lot of research required to understand whether a fortification or a beverage like tea is possible with probiotics, because there is a heating process involved. How these things will last in such conditions and all, we need to understand, and a lot of research need to be done in that. And if I say that ideal vehicle, I would say that beverages, among that fruit juices and tea. Tea has got the highest penetration among beverages next to water. So water and tea can be considered as ideal beverages, and we need to see that how best is possible, and a lot of research need to be done in that area.
Thank you so much, Dr. David. Thank you very much. Devyanshi, any more questions?
Well, we do have more questions, but due to the time constraint,
have 2 minutes for a quick take home from each one of our panel members? Just 2 minutes more. So a crisp take home.
Yes, we can shell out 1 minute for that.
Okay. So crisp take home, Dr. Adam, just in a very crisp.
So important to understand and work with scientifically documented probiotic strains and understand the science and get that message out so clearly to the consumers that these are very specific but very, very important work.
Yes, thank you. Dr. Kajal, very crisp. We just have 1 minute for all five members.
I think everyone, we have to encourage citizens for taking probiotics as a part of their life to for future health and nutrition for the country as well as for the individual persons. So this is a high time that we take these things forward and make our future secured and better for health and nutrition.
Thank you, Dr. Kajal. Thank you very much. Prabhakar ji, one crisp take home.
Yeah. So I'll again actually suggest that there has to be mass label communication and awareness about probiotic among the larger population rather than only in city areas. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Sanjay ji, one last take home.
Yes. I was just thinking as a food technologist, for example, when we think about the food, it is mostly fermented and liquid products. But see, for example, already probiotics have entered into baby food also. Viable spores are available and they can be paired and they can be added into the dry formats of the food. So there is a lot to do. There is a lot to design products with probiotics. That is what I would say.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjay ji. And last but not the least, Dr. David.
What excited me to hear that the need of science and research to support what probiotics can do for NCDs, that would be a great take back I wanted to
take. Excellent. Thank you very much. Thank you, Devyanshi. Thank you to each one of the panel members. It's been a very interesting, very exciting panel discussion. And I have learned a lot during this panel discussion. So thank you very much for your time. And thank you, Devyanshi, Synapse Group, for this excellent opportunity. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we sign off.
Thank you so much to all the panel members for joining in and sharing in your wonderful insights. And also, due to time constraints, we do not take up all the questions. But if required, I will share it across with you and you can address the same.
Thank you.
Dr. Nidya Hajela for wonderfully moderating this panel session. Thank you so much, and we look forward to seeing you in our next channel.
Thank you so much. Thanks.